There can be a lot of information about a particular flow field that we know. For example, we might know velocity and pressure and temperature all throughout some three-dimensional domain, for example. So if you just look at velocity, for example, that has three components, and then you have pressure, that's a fourth component. And at every point in this flow, in this domain, it can have a different velocity and a different pressure. And so, you know, once we compute this or we can measure it from experimental data, there's got to be a way to visualize this. And so we're going to talk about four different methods of visualization. The first is called a streamline. So streamlines, and let me just draw an example of this here. So a streamline about an airfoil, for example, is the locus of points or the curve that goes through a flow field that is tangent to the velocity at every point in the flow. So in two dimensions, we can kind of visualize this a little bit easier. But if I have a velocity field, you look at the velocity that might flow over an airfoil. You know, we have this whole flow field full of these velocities. And these are, in a three-dimensional world, they would be three-component vectors. Here in the two-dimensional world, it's a two-component vector that would represent the velocity field around this airfoil. So a streamline is simply the curve or the locus of points that is tangential to that velocity vector at every point in the flow. And so there are a lot of streamlines. You know, you can start at any location upstream. So you can start at any location here and just march downstream, and using some integration method, you can figure out where the streamline is going to go if you know the velocity at every point in that flow. And so what we usually see, let me just get rid of all this stuff around here. This set of streamlines would just look something like this and allow us to visualize what that flow looks like as it goes around this airfoil. Okay, so that's an example of a streamline. The next possibility we're going to discuss here is called a streak line. And a streak line is a locus of points that passed through a given point. And usually these, I'm going to draw this actually over a three-dimensional wing. Let's say that I've got a center line here and I've got a wing sitting in a wind tunnel. And a lot of times the way that we visualize streak lines are we put what's called a rake upstream of that wing, and that rake might have these different ports on it, and we emit a smoke or some particle into the flow field. And we let that particle move downstream, and at some time then we take a snapshot of what all of these particles look like. So let's look at all the particles that emitted from this this little point on the rake, and it might have come around so these are particles that emitted from different points on this rake. So we can take a snapshot, and if we had enough particles here, then this would look like a continuous line, a streak line. And this is the locus of particles that all passed through some location upstream. They all pass through that point at one time. And then we can look at where they are if we take a snapshot of the flow, And that helps us visualize somewhat what's happening to this flow field, you know, as it moves across the wing. So that's called a streak line. The next option is a path line. And a path line, I'll actually do the same type of thing here. Let's look at a wing, and here's a center plane. A path line is a little different than a streak line. It's actually the path, if we followed one particle as it moved down the stream here and looked at its path that it takes, that's called a path line. So that's just following a single particle. And then finally, we've got a timeline. And a timeline is a little different way of looking at the flow. Basically, what it would be is if we, let's again look at a wing here in a wind tunnel, and we would have a bunch of points here at the beginning at time t equals zero, for example. And so if we could emit a pulse, a really quick pulse of smoke into this stream, and then wait, you know, 3 seconds or so, a few seconds, and then look down, look at where all of those points are, it might look something like this, and then a few seconds later, it might look like this, and then a few seconds later, it might look something like this. So this timeline, then, basically we can connect all these dots. All of these dots were adjacent to each other at time t equals zero. And then, so let's just write that out, t equals zero, and then this is going to be t at time step one, at time step two, at time step three. And we can connect all these dots, and we can look at, that gives us some idea of the shape of this flow. Now, I haven't done a very good job representing what that might look like for flow over a wing, but you get the idea that these are points that were at one time perfectly adjacent to each other at time t equals zero, but because they speed up and slow down in different parts of the flow field, looking at all of those points later in time gives us some idea of what that flow field looks like. So these are the four main things: a streamline, the streak line, a path line, and a timeline. Now, the streamlines, the streak lines, and the timelines, so let's just these three here, are really snapshots at one time in the flow, because a flow might be transient, you know, it may be changing with time, may not be a steady state flow, and so the streamline, the streak line, and the timeline are just really, they give us an idea of what the flow looks like at some snapshots. The timeline, we have these four different snapshots, but the streak line and the streamline are just a single snapshot, and it tells us what's happening at that instance. The path line is really a time history. So let's connect these all here. These are a snapshot, and the path line is a time history. So it tells us something about the history of that flow, because we've followed a single particle through that flow, and so we can look back in time at what that flow kind of looked like and what it looks like later in time. So for a steady state flow, if the flow is in steady state, the streamline, the streak line, and the path line actually all look identical. So these are identical for a steady state flow. That means that flow is not changing with time. The velocity in that flow at that location does not change with time. And that's a pretty common thing in aerodynamics. Usually we're looking at steady states, steady state lift or drag, and basically we're looking at this flow in this constant state where things are not changing with time. Okay, I'd like to talk about streamlines in a little bit more detail here for just a moment. One interesting thing about the streamline is that because it's a curve that represents or that is tangent to the velocity at every point in the flow. That means that mass cannot cross that line. So mass cannot cross a streamline. That's really important because there's a lot we can learn from a streamline then. If we have this snapshot of the flow, let's look at this airfoil for just a moment. And I haven't done a great job representing this, but it's not too bad here. So because mass cannot cross a streamline, that means that, let's take this first streamline, for example, or this inner streamline. We have a certain amount of mass at this location. Maybe I should change colors here for a moment. We've got a certain amount of mass at this location. That means as I go downstream to this location, for example, we have to have the same amount of mass passing through that location as we did the previous location. Let's split this in half for a second. Let's put a streamline here in the middle. So we kind of break that up. Let's take these off and add our streamline here to kind of cut that up, and then we'll look at the mass just in the upper streamline here. So we have a certain amount of mass entering between these two adjacent streamlines, and that is the same amount of mass that's passing through this location and this location and this location. You know, at each of these locations, we have to have the same amount of mass passing through there because the mass cannot exit that streamline. So the distance between two neighboring streamlines tell us a lot about this flow. If those streamlines are really close together, that means that the flow has higher velocity in that region, and it has a lower velocity in places where that streamline is or where the streamlines are further apart. So if we assume that all of these streamlines started off at identical distances to each other, delta y or something, then as we look downstream, we can identify areas of really slow flow. So in this region, for example, that flow is going really slowly compared to this region right here where we'd have really high speed flow. And that's because these streamlines are so much further apart right here than they are here. And we know we have the same amount of mass passing through those two locations if upstream those streamlines were all evenly spaced.